Okay, so thank you very much, Federica, for the introduction and organizing this meeting. I think it's a really great idea to try to get all those people talking to each other. And so maybe because there are so many people not from Contact Topology, I should briefly say who I am. I mean, I'm Patrick Massot and I'm working in Contact Topology, but it has been revealed before the talk started that I've, in the last 3 years, I've been mostly explaining mathematics to computers. And if you want, we can discuss during the informal discussion why I think it's a good idea. But what I'm going to explain today is regular topology without anything formal and mostly pictures. So in all those different corners of mathematics that were mentioned, we all use contact structures or more general tangent distributions, but we come from very different places. And so the way we see contact structure interacting with the rest of mathematics is different. And so, yeah, if you, I mean, I saw that Pierre Pansu is going to give a talk later in the week, and I believe he came from to contact geometry from the study of symmetric spaces and stuff happening at infinity in symmetric spaces and Mostow rigidity and stuff like that. And there are people who think they are, I mean, people who are doing PDEs and think that elliptic operators are boring and hypoelliptics would be better, and they start doing contact geometry like that. And of course, this influences a lot what you're doing with your contact structure. So the goal of today's talk will be to explain how we in contact topology see contact geometry interacting with other stuff and mostly symplectic geometry, and what kind of questions we ask and what kinds of phenomena we try to understand because we come from that direction. And tomorrow I will emphasize more interactions with geometry and curvature and sub-Riemannian geometry, and that this will be mostly about conjectures, but today is a survey of contact topology from our point of view, contact geometry from our topological point of view. So if you already know contact topology, you won't learn anything. So you should rather go and explain mathematics to your computer and just come back for the next talk. So for us, the contact geometry starts with the manifold of contact elements. So I start with any manifold M. So we have a manifold M, and we fix a point, a small m in capital M, and we look at all co-oriented hyperplanes in the tangent bundle and tangent space to capital M at little m. And this is the space of contact elements at this point M. So you can see it as a quotient of the cotangent space at that point without zero and by multiplication by positive real number. So you see this is topologically a sphere. So now if I move small m, you get a bundle. And on this bundle, on the total space of this bundle, there is a hyperplane field, which is defined like this. At any point h in this total space, you just look at the hyperplane, which is the pre-image by the differential of the projection of H. And this gives you a hyperplane field on this total space Cn. And this is a very efficient way not to explain what this thing is doing. So now let me explain it. If we can find, yeah, you still see stuff?
You still yes. See
anything? Yeah. So this is, The blue thing is M, is the manifold, and you see there is this point in red, the small m point, and I have a hyperplane in the tangent space, so it's simply a line, the orange line, and it's co-oriented, so there is this green arrow. And if I move my point, my hyperplane, you see above this picture, there is a black thing, which is actually a circle, because the top and the bottom are identified. And each yellow point on this circle corresponds to a co-oriented hyperplane at the bottom. You see, so we've got this circle which is above the red point, and each point of the circle is a co-oriented line. So co-oriented means there is a positive side, which is indicated by the green thing, and a negative side. And now I said there is a contact structure in this picture, because just look at the hyperplane in the three manifold above the surface, which is tangent to the circle and projects down to the hyperplane that I've chosen. Okay, so this is the canonical contact structure on the bundle of contact elements over a surface in this case. And I should probably say also that most of this talk will be about three-dimensional contact topology, and it's not only because I like drawing pictures, also because I think that interactions with sub-Riemannian geometry are much more likely to happen first in dimension three and maybe later in higher dimension. Now, there are nice curves that you can draw in this picture. If you start with a curve in the surface, at each point of the curve, you've got a tangent line. And if I choose a co-orientation for the curve, you've got a co-oriented tangent line at each point in the of the curve. So correspondingly, you've got a curve upstairs in the bundle of contact elements. And this curve is everywhere tangent to the contact structure. I mean, it's pretty clear, if you think about it, that it's everywhere tangent to the contact structure, because the contact plane projects down to the associated co-oriented line. Okay? And these curves, we call them Legendrian curves, and other users of contact geometry like to call them horizontal curves. The issue is this: in this example, they are not horizontal because the contact structure is everywhere vertical. So we'll stick to Legendrian curves in dimension three or isotropic curves in a higher dimension as our preferred way of talking about this. Okay. People should ask questions. I mean, people who are not working in contact topology should feel free to ask questions, because if you only wait for, I don't know, Alvaro and Federica to enjoy the show, listening to mathematics they already know, it's completely pointless. So please don't hesitate to interrupt me.
Also, maybe, sorry, I'm interrupting because I want to say, if you don't feel like interrupting Patrick and you want to ask a question in the chat, then I will interrupt Patrick and ask the question.
Good. Okay, let's move on. So now we have automorphisms of this contact manifold. So the diffeomorphisms of M act on the bundle of contact elements. If you've got a map phi from M to M, which is a diffeomorphism, then you can just lift it to a map phi hat from this bundle of contact elements to itself, simply sending a co-oriented hyperplane to its image under the differential of phi. And I claim that this is preserving psi, because, I mean, you know, this this map preserves the vibration, so it looks like this. So the bundle projects to M, and phi hat is lifting this phi map. So it sends the tangent space to the fibers to the tangent space to the fiber. And in the other direction, the M direction, then it's tautologically sent to the right place, because if you look at what T phi hat is doing to the inverse image of H, I mean, it has to be the inverse image of the T phi of H, simply because that diagram commutes. So this is preserving the contact structure. And there is also flows that preserve the contact structure and that are not at all fibered like this. And there are the flows coming from the geodesic flows. So if you start with a co-oriented hyperplane like this, then you look at this vector, which is the unit length vector perpendicular to H, and just flow it by the geodesic flow. And this will be sent, so this is say the geodesic flow is phi t, and this will be phi t of v, and the orthogonal here will be, I don't know, psi t of h, where psi t is the induced map on Cn. Okay, and I know I put a small Dutch flag here, so I need some a native speaker to say the name. So the fact that Psi T preserves Xi is called, I don't know, I need someone. So I wrote the name, but you should feel free not to use any of the letters that I wrote. So is there any Dutch native speaker that can say this name?
Huygens.
Great, very creative, thanks. So this is this Sun principle, like they said. Says that Psi T preserve Xi. Right. And we'll be interested in those flows. And there's also another property that is important, is that if you differentiate this flow with respect to T, you get a vector field generating the flow. And this vector field is transverse to Xi. Just moves transversely to the contact structure of this flow. So now, just quickly recall the fundamental definition from our point of view. A contact structure on an oriented manifold, so 2n minus 1 dimensional for us, is a co-oriented hyperplane field which is locally isomorphic to the one we just saw in the example. So I've oriented everything and co-oriented everything. This is not strictly necessary, but it just makes things easier and just decreases slightly the probability that I will say something wrong at some point. So those are the contact structures. Hyperplane fields, and locally they look like the picture that we had before, the picture here. And a submanifold is called isotropic or horizontal if you insist, if its tangent bundle is inside Xi, so if it's everywhere tangent to Xi. And we call it Legendrian if, in addition to being isotropic, its dimension is n minus 1 if the ambient dimension is 2n minus 1. So this is the maximal dimension for submanifolds tangent to a contact structure. But because I will mostly stick to dimension 3 in all the examples, Legendrian submanifolds will be curves. So one-dimensional submanifold. So those contact manifolds, they come from their automorphism group, which is a group of diffeomorphism preserving the contact structures. And among flows of automorphisms, the ones we like best are the red flows. So they are the flows of automorphism which are transverse to Xi. So again, transverse to Xi in the same sense as in the previous slide. So I've got a group morphism from R to an automorphism of Vxi, so that would be a flow of automorphism. And I ask that the T derivative is a vector field which is transverse to Xi. So it's pointing outside of Xi. Okay, so hopefully, at least you have equivalent definitions for all this in mind, except maybe for people who are really from the analysis side of this workshop, then maybe you don't have any definition at all. But if you have a definition, then it should be equivalent at least to what is written on this slide. Okay. So in particular, we get what is called the standard contact structure on R3, because the bundle of contact elements of R2, if you just unwrap on all the circles, and you get R3, and if you pull back the contact structure by this universal cover map, the plane field that you get on R3 is just the picture that is here on my slide. And there is also an explicit equation. This is the kernel of the one form cosine z dx minus sine z dy. And we call it the standard contact structure on R3. And now come symplectic geometry. So on a cotangent bundle of a manifold, we have a nice symplectic form. So it's defined by its primitive and lambda at a point P. So if you've got P somewhere in a cotangent bundle, so P is a linear form on some tangent space at some point of the manifold, then lambda at this point P evaluated on a vector V is P of the projection of V. So the thing is like this, you've got M down below and the tangent bundle, cotangent bundle is over there, and P is seen both as a point in this total space and as a linear form on the tangent space here to the projection of P by is like this. And if you start with a vector V here, you just push it down and evaluate P on it, and you get a vector field, one form lambda, and its differential is called a canonical symplectic form on T star M. And note that if you now look at the radial vector field in each fibers and you plug it in the first position inside these two form omega, then you get back lambda. It is really the example to have in mind. And now if you look at a hyperplane inside a hypersurface inside this cotangent bundle, and so inside this cotangent bundle, you've got the zero section somewhere. So this is the zero section. And if I look at the hyperplane field, which is a hypersurface, which is here, and it intersects each fiber along a convex domain containing zero in its interior. So that would be this part here. So for instance, you could take the unit ball for some Riemannian metric. If you start with a Riemannian metric on M, you get a scalar products on T star M, and just look at the unit ball bundle. But under this assumption on V, if you look at the projection we had from the cotangent bundle minus the zero section to the space of contact element, it projects V diffeomorphically onto the contact element, because V intersects every orbit of the action of by multiplication by positive real numbers exactly once transversely. And now this lambda that we had, it induces a one form on V. And if you look at the kernel of this one form, then you get back the contact structure that we started with. The contact structure, the canonical contact structure on the bundle of contact elements of M. So you see, in the beginning, this bundle of contact element, it was purely from differential topology. You give me a differentiable manifold, then the differentiable manifold comes equipped with its tangent bundle, so it comes also equipped with its contact element bundles. And on these contact element bundles, for free, you get a hyperplane field just by a completely tautological construction. And that was the intrinsic view on this contact structure on the bundle of contact elements. But you can also get it as appearing somehow magically on the boundary of a symplectic manifold, which is, say, for instance, a disk bundle in a cotangent bundle. Or this bundle, maybe for a Finsler metric, if you start with general convex domains in this construction. Okay, so we see that contact structures can appear on the boundary of symplectic manifolds. Now, we can abstract a bit this discussion and arrive at the definition of symplectic convexity. So now I start with any symplectic manifold. So it's a manifold equipped with a differential two form, which is locally isomorphic to the example we had before. Then I said a boundary of W is omega convex. If there is some vector field which does the same thing as what we saw on the previous slide, it's at least defined near the boundary. So the picture is like this. I've got W is, we draw it like this in contact topology. W, and this is the boundary of W. And Z is going out of W along the boundary. And we draw it diverging like this because we ask that the So this is equivalent, this D of omega of Z stuff is omega. You can also say that the Lie derivative of omega in the direction of Z is omega. So Z is expanding the symplectic form. And so this is why we draw it diverging like this. Okay, so this is the definition of convexity in symplectic geometry. And it's a pretty bad use of the word convex. I mean, previously I said that calling horizontal curves horizontal was a bad idea, but this is much worse. Because this is a condition that is only very vaguely related to your intuition of convexity. But we'll see it's related to something on the complex geometry side, which is much closer to the intuitive meaning of convexity. Anyway, in this situation, if you look at this one form omega of Z something and restrict it to the tangent bundle at the boundary, you get a contact structure. And you look at the kernel, you get a contact structure. So exactly as on the previous slide, we recovered some contact structure on the boundary of a disk bundle, disk cotangent bundle of any manifold. And the disk contact structure, it depends on Z, which is not unique, but its deformation class depends only on the symplectic structure. And switching perspectives, if we start with a contact manifold, and we can realize it like this up to isomorphism as the boundary of a symplectic manifold in this situation, in this omega convex situation, then we say that the contact manifold, so the boundary equipped with the contact structure, is symplectically fillable. And we say strongly symplectically fillable because there are variations that I won't really discuss today. So you don't really need to remember the specific details of this definition. You need to remember that on the boundary of a symplectic manifold, under some geometric circumstances, you get a contact structure. And those geometric circumstances, for instance, happen in for cotangent disk bundles. Now, there are other examples. If you start simply with the ball in the standard symplectic space, then you can use as a Z vector field the radial vector field. So Z is the sum of xi dxi plus yi dyi. So this is what I call the radial vector field in the vector space. It's independent of coordinate, I mean, just the tautological vector field on a vector space. Then if I look at this one form omega of Z something, so I need to plug this vector field into this one form, and you see I will get sum over I, xi, dyi, and then be careful of the minus sign when plugging d over dyi inside this two form, you get minus yi dxi. And in polar coordinate, that would be sum of ri squared d theta I in polar coordinate. And if you restrict this to the boundary, so now they on S2n minus 1, boundary of a ball, you get the kernel of this sum of ri squared di squared di d theta I restricted to tangent space of S to n minus 1. And this gives a contact structure on the sphere, and we call it the standard contact structure on the sphere. And of course, if you remove one point from the sphere, you get a Euclidean space again, and say using a stereographic projection, and we get again a standard contact structure on the Euclidean space. Okay.
Patrick, may I interrupt you just a second?
Maybe I've got sign miss, factor of two missing, 1/2. Yeah. Federica, yeah?
Yeah, no, there's a question for you. So, Valentina, please go ahead.
Yeah, sorry, just to check that I am following. You were using this, like introducing this symplectic convexity. Did I understand correctly? This is one of the conditions under which you can get a conduct structure out of a symplectic manifold?
Yes, this is exactly what you need to remember. From the previous slide, you need to remember. So you start with a manifold W. And on W, there is a symplectic form, omega. So it's a two form that is locally isomorphic to the one of the previous slide. You can also characterize it locally in terms of calculus by saying it's a closed two form, which is non-degenerate in the bilinear algebra sense. But anyway, so you start with omega, and on the boundary of W, you want to get a contact structure, and there is some geometric condition, and this geometric condition is pictured here. It involves a vector field which goes out of boundary of W and expands exponentially W. Okay. And in this case, I say that maybe up to factor of two somewhere. If you look at this Z, it clearly goes transversely out of the boundary of the ball. So this is Z. And if you, so remember the condition was that the differential of omega where you insert Z in first position should be omega again. And it works here because if I differentiate this, I got twice omega. This is why I added one half in front. Mm-hmm. And I said that in this situation, so both my conditions are met. So on the boundary, which is the sphere S2n minus 1, I get a contact structure, which is the kernel of this one form lambda. Okay?
Okay, thank you.
Thanks for asking. Now, I can also start with a contact manifold and go towards symplectic geometry. And then at the end of the slide, I will go in the other direction again. They're all basic moves in contact geometry. So I can even start with any hyperplane field on any manifold. So psi could be any hyperplane field. So at each point, I've got a hyperplane in the tangent bundle. And inside the cotangent bundle, I look at all the covectors whose kernel with its co-orientation is the hyperplane I'm considering. And the claim, I mean, it's a nice exercise to check that a hyperplane field is contact if and only if this submanifold inside the cotangent bundle of V is symplectic. I mean, it's a nice exercise if you have some characterization of contact structure. With the definition of contact structure that I gave, it's nice, but it's a non-trivial exercise. So you need to first learn how to check locally that a hyperplane field is, to check by a calculus that a contact that a hyperplane field is contact structure. Now, what I say is that if you have a symplectic manifold with an omega convex hypersurface, so say with omega convex boundary, but it could be another hypersurface in W, not necessarily the boundary, then near this hypersurface, W looks like a piece of this so-called symplectization of Xi. So this is called the, after this line, S Xi is called the symplectization of Xi, of V Xi. Symplectization of VXI. So every contact manifold comes equipped for free with a symplectic manifold. And topologically, this symplectic manifold is diffeomorphic to a product of V with positive real numbers. Because of course, if you look at all the P's that could be good in this definition, then they are all multiple, positive multiple of each other. So this is topologically isomorphic to V times positive real number, which is of course the same as V times all real numbers from a topological point of view. If you want to go in the other direction, going from a symplectic manifold to a contact manifold, then you need to assume the symplectic manifold is exact. You need to assume the symplectic form is the differential of some one form. And then in this situation, again, you can take a product and get a contact manifold, which essentially is attached to the symplectic structure. You need to be a bit careful. We should at least say the contact structure is well defined only up to deformation. Okay, so those are the basic links between symplectic manifold and contact manifolds. Now, for instance, we can start with R2 seen as a cotangent bundle of R, and we have this primitive, which is the Liouville form I mentioned before, so in coordinates it's PDQ. And so you get a contact structure, which is the kernel of DT plus PDQ using this construction from the last slide. So this is the picture that you get. So the T direction is drawn only, say, for T equals zero. And the P direction is going from left to right on the picture, and the Q direction is going from front to back in this picture. So you can see, for instance, the lines, the horizontal lines directed by d over dp are tangent to the contact structure. And for p equals zero, the other direction, this is the p is tangent to the contact structure. But you could also start with a different primitive for essentially the same symplectic structure. You could start with the canonical primitive you have on the symplectic vector space, which is the radial one, the one we already saw in the slide about the sphere. And in that case, if you go to R2 times R, you get this picture with a contact structure which is invariant under rotation around the T axis. And this picture, we call it the standard contact structure on R3. And then maybe you're starting to get upset because this is at least the third, maybe the fourth picture that I show, and I call it the standard contact structure on R3, and no two of them are the same. And that's a very important point, because in contact topology, we really care about contact structures only up to diffeomorphism, or maybe up to isotopy if we fixed a manifold to diffeomorphism isotopic to the identity. And all those diffeomorphisms, they don't respect geometry at all. I mean, all those different pictures that I call the standard contact structure on R3, they are very different geometry. And they are associated to different Lie groups. For instance, the bundle of contact elements of R2, it's clearly a homogeneous space under the action of the Euclidean affine transformations of the plane. And this picture is naturally attached to the Heisenberg group, which is not the same Lie group as the one I just mentioned before. And they have very different geometric properties, but from a contact topology perspective, they are all the same. And if you just ask a contact topologist, what is the standard contact structure on R3, you just get equidistributed answer among all those pictures. Now, last link, a very important link between contact geometry and symplectic geometry is we can go from Hamiltonian dynamics to Rabe dynamics. So remember, on a symplectic manifold, each time you have a function H for Hamilton, you've got a vector field. So for instance, if you start with R2n seen as a cotangent bundle of Rn, so the symplectic form is sum of dpi dqi, and H is the kinetic energy plus potential energy, you get the Newton equations. So XH would be in that case sum of PI DQI. So PI is indeed the velocity plus the potential term. No. And this is how symplectic geometry is related to classical mechanics. And now if I assume that my function h has the boundary of W as a regular level set, so it's a pre-inverse of inverse image of zero, and this boundary is convex, then I XH is tangent to the boundary because all those vector fields, they are tangent to the levels of H, because if you plug XH inside the formula on top, you see that DH of XH is zero. So maybe I should write this. Note that DH of XH is minus omega XH XH. XH is zero. So if you assume that the boundary is a level set of H, then you get a vector field which is tangent to the boundary. And I claim that this vector field is it generates a red flow. It's a red vector field. Its flow preserves the contact structure and it's transverse to the contact structure. And the example is the geodesic flow where H is defined on the cotangent bundle of some manifold. By the formula H of PQ, QP is the norm of P square. So the geodesic flow that we already met is an example of this link between Hamilton dynamics and Rebbe dynamics. And so we see that the dynamics of Rebbe flows include the very classical topics of classical mechanics and geodesic flows. Geodesic flow is a kind of special case of classical mechanics. And now the last interaction is with complex geometry. So we start with a manifold where each tangent space is not only a real vector space, but also a C vector space. So maybe because W is equipped with an atlas where transition maps are holomorphic maps, so then W is actually a complex manifold, then of course you get a complex vector space structure on all its tangent bundles, but there are other examples. I mean, you can equip a real manifold. Of course, they have to be even dimensional, but under some conditions, you can equip tangent space consistently with complex vector space structure. And I guess for historical reason, we denote by capital J the multiplication by I in those C vector spaces. And especially when they don't come from a holomorphic atlas. Now for every real hypersurface inside W, you get for free coming from the complex structure that we've chosen on our tangent bundle, a hyperplane field on V. Just look at the largest complex subspace in the tangent space. Because the tangent space, because V is a hypersurface, it has a real dimension, odd real dimension, and so it cannot be a complex subspace itself. But inside it, there is a largest complex subspace, and it's simply the intersection between the tangent space of V with its image under multiplication by I, so its image under J. And this is a real hyperplane field that you get on any hypersurface in what is called an almost complex manifold. So for instance, if you start with S3 or S2n minus 1 inside Cn, then the tangent space to the sphere is the orthogonal of Z, so for any Z in the sphere. And so this is the first piece, is the tangent space, and then you intersect with J times this tangent space. You get this hyperplane. And in the three-dimensional case, I mean, using stereographic projection, I can put this in R3. And stereographic projection is conformal. So the orthogonal is still the orthogonal. So you see that what you get is the psi is perpendicular to the Hopf vibrations. So the Hopf fibers are drawn on this picture by my friend Benoit. And it's hard to see what it looks like because Benoit chose a nice sample of Hopf fiber. But if you move to a something more focused on one ray. So I've drawn Hopf circles in R3, but only the ones passing through some ray perpendicular to the z-axis. And then you can see the contact distribution rotating along this ray. And this way, I mean, you've guessed it, this picture, we call it the standard contact structure on R3. And you may think we already seen that version, but no. And it's a variation on the version we had a couple of slides ago. I mean, it looks like this one, but this one is doing only one quarter of the turn on each ray from the z-axis to infinity. And that one is doing half a turn from the axis to infinity. But it does not complete that half turn in finite distance. That is very important for things to come later. Now, there is a definition of complex convexity. And so again, you start with some W. And maybe this is it. W is now a complex manifold, so almost complex manifold. It's equipped with a multiplication by I on each tangent space. And inside, there is V, which is the regular level set of some function f, say. And at least locally. And I look at this hyperplane field that I defined before. You can actually get an equation for this for those hyperplanes using the differential of the function. Of course, the differential of the function itself is an equation for the tangent space to V. So that would be here. You've got the tangent space is the kernel of the differential of f. But if you precompose this differential by multiplication by I and restrict to this tangent space, you get an equation of the contact structure. Well, it's not yet a contact structure if I don't put any assumption of my hypersurface. Now I've got a quadratic form on Xi, which is the differential of this DF composed J. And we say that V is J convex or strictly pseudo convex. If this quadratic form is positive definite on Xi. So this means LF on Xi is positive definite. And now this looks like proper convexity. I mean, this Levy form is a version of the second fundamental form of a hypersurface in Riemannian geometry. And it tells you in particular, and this is very important for things that Francesco will be discussing, that under this condition of J convexity, holomorphic curves, so map from one-dimensional complex manifolds to W, are locally on the positive side of V. So for instance, if V is the boundary of something, there is no image of a one-dimensional complex manifold, so a complex curve, which is tangent from the inside like this. This is forbidden. Exactly like when you have a Riemannian convexity, and the boundary of a domain is convex, is a geodesic that starts tangent to the boundary, they are locally outside of the boundary, outside of the domain. Okay, and there is no need to remember any formula from this slide. What you need to remember is that this Levy form is a kind of second fundamental form in complex geometry. And again, convexity, which is positive definite second fundamental form, gives a contact structure on the boundary. Now, those are the interactions we are interested in contact geometry. So, based on those interactions, I forgot one slide, sorry. What is this? Yeah, I explained the interactions between contact and symplectic on one side, and interaction between contact and complex on the other side. But actually, those are not independent interactions. You can do both at the same time. And the best case scenario is the case of Keller manifolds. So Keller manifold is a holomorphic manifold equipped to the symplectic form. So you've got both complex structure, and it really comes from holomorphic charts. And the symplectic form, and the compatibility condition between those two structures is that out of the symplectic form and the complex structure, you can build a Riemannian metric, simply sending uv to omega of ujv. Remember, j is multiplication by I. And though this is the very classical topic of Keller geometry, but Gromov in 85 said we can do actually things from the start with a symplectic form. You can always get some J if you don't insist that J should be really a complex structure, that it comes from a holomorphic atlas. If you simply ask for complex space structure on your tangent spaces, then you can always find some J given omega. And they are essentially unique, I mean, up to homotopy. And now the interaction with contact geometry are compatible too. I mean, if you have a symplectic filling of a contact manifold, so the symplectic structure and the contact structure are compatible, then you can arrange when you construct J following Gromov that this contact structure is the space of is given by maximal complex subspaces, and the boundary is J convex. So it's both omega convex, convex in the sense of symplectic geometry, and convex in the sense of complex geometry. Now that you've seen where we come from, we have lots of questions. And then there are, again, they are not the same questions you would have if you come from analysis, or you come from symmetric spaces, or you come from control theory, or stuff like that. I mean, the main questions that come from where we are, first, if you give me a manifold, odd-dimensional manifold, is there any contact structure? And if there are contact structures, how many of them they are up to deformation, or up to isomorphism, or something? Just classify contact structure. They are not easy to build, because they are defined by this local model, and it's not clear how to glue pieces of this local model. So this first class of question. And the second class of questions is, if you fix a contact manifold with a contact structure, is it the boundary of some symplectic manifold, or is it the boundary of some complex manifold? And if yes, I mean, if your contact structure happens to be the boundary of a symplectic manifold, does it remember the topology of the symplectic manifold? So if you, I mean, does it remember, I mean, it's homology, or maybe even everything. Maybe there is only one symplectic filling or stuff like that. So that's the second class of questions. And now remember, we had this dynamical system starting with geodesic flows and classical mechanics. And those are special class of dynamical system, continuous time dynamical systems. Are they special in any way? I mean, do they have special properties or not? I mean, they are volume preserving, but how do they compare to all the volume preserving flows? It's not clear. And also, it's not clear what they see from the contact structure. For instance, can I say if I've got a rape flow on a contact manifold that is this dynamical property and this dynamical property, then can I deduce anything about the contact structure? So do they see the contact structure? And of course, always in geometry, if you give me some geometric structure, it has an automorphism group. So remember, we saw in the bundle of contact elements, diffeomorphism of the base lift to contact automorphisms. And geodesic flows, of course, also are contact automorphisms. So I can study this group. And it's a topological group. It has a topology as a subgroup of the group of all diffeomorphisms, so it's smooth topology. And what are the properties of this group? I mean, algebraic property, I mean, is it a simple group? Is it a perfect group? Stuff like that. Or geometry, can you put a nice geometry on this group? Or simply topological properties, how many connected components there are? Are they complicated connected components or not? This is the fourth kind of questions. Are there any questions so far? Because we are almost done and I'm starting to worry that maybe I lost the connection and nobody is listening to me.
No.
You're there.
I can reassure you. We can still hear you and see the slides.
Okay.
And there's a question. So Valentina, please ask your question.
Yeah, it's still Valentina. And actually, it's about the second question that you listed here on the last slide. Because I had in mind something that you just said. So at some point you were talking about, let me go back, sorry, a second, simplification of something, this SC.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess, so I had in mind, maybe that and that was wrong, I guess, so that this SXI was exactly the symplectic manifold that was filling somehow the
exact
structure.
That's a very good question, because I forget a very important word. That's my fault. So I want compact symplectic manifold, because you see the problem with the symplectization is that it looks like this. And so this is the symplectization, and you can put a section. So this symplectization is a bundle over the manifold where psi lives. So you can put choose a section here. So a section of this bundle is exactly a one form defining psi, an equation for psi. And then forget about the part that is above this section, because it's convex when you see it from below here. But the issue is that the side on the bottom part is non-compact. Okay? So indeed, there is no obstruction to starting a symplectic manifold filling any contact manifold. But the issue is somehow, how do you close up at the bottom?
Okay.
You messed up this definition by forgetting the compact word. Sorry about that.
No, thank you.
Other questions? Actually, so maybe I should stop here, because I've explained the scene, and then my plan was to give a couple of answers to those main questions, I mean, especially the historically important ones. And I thought I would start doing that today and finish tomorrow, and then discuss open questions about relations with sub-Riemannian geometry tomorrow. But since I'm almost over time, then probably I should stop here. And tomorrow I will describe quickly some answers. I mean, quickly, maybe not quickly.
So let me.
And then I will explain conjectures and. About relations with geometry and curvature and sub-Riemannian geometry.
Okay, Patrick, let me just jump in here. So I think, so let me say, I think if you would like to have 5 more minutes in view of this technical problems we had in the beginning, that would be fine. It's also totally fine if you think this is a good moment to stop. And then I would maybe stop the recording so that maybe people will feel more comfortable asking more questions. Is that a good plan?
Yeah, I think it's good. I mean, this is really a natural stopping point, and you can just ask questions.
Okay. So let me let's first thank Patrick for his talk. So I'll stop recording here.